We welcome you to this Easter Sunday worship service at Alps Road Presbyterian Church. We are glad you're here to worship with us. Now, we would love to be worshiping in person today, but we are worshiping online. But we are excited that you're here to worship with us, and we have a what we think is a wonderful worship service for you. Now, today we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Death could not hold him, and death became life. Darkness became light, and sadness became joy because of the resurrection. Now, a couple of things about the service today. One is that we are going to use some recordings from previous occasions. We have our opening and our closing hymn from last year's Easter service, and we think you are going to enjoy those. And we also have a couple of recordings from previous times that we think you will also especially like. Now, we won't have the opportunity after the service today to take pictures at the cross in front of the church, which is something we typically do. But at the end of the service today, we are going to show some pictures from last year at the cross and also some of the pictures that you have sent online to us this year. And you'll want to take some moments and be sure and look at those. Now, traditional greeting on Easter Sunday morning is for the pastor to say, "Christ the Lord is risen." And the congregation responds, "He is risen indeed." So I'd like to invite you to join with me and respond in that way. Christ the Lord is risen. Christ the Lord is risen. Christ the Lord is risen. Would you join with me in prayer? Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to gather on Easter Sunday morning. And though we are gathering in our homes and online, we ask that you will be among us as we remember this remarkable event in the life of Jesus, that death could not hold him, that the grave could not conquer him, but that he conquered death and rose to new life so that we also might have the promise of forgiveness and grace and eternal life in him. Lord, we ask that you will be among us and grant us your Holy Spirit as we celebrate this special moment in the life of our Savior. Be among us, we ask, and we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning. Happy Easter. Will you join me in our Easter prayer? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we gather to celebrate your presence with us, to offer you our praise and our prayers, our love and our obedience. Through the gift of your own Spirit, you abide with us and in us. We rejoice in your love for us and in the life we have been given through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. Open our eyes to see your presence here among us. Open our hearts to the love that you have for us. Open our minds to the truth you will reveal to us. All glory and praise to you, Triune God, now and forevermore. Amen.
This morning for our children's time, I thought we'd do something special. Since we weren't able to have our Easter egg hunt this year, I have organized a special Easter egg hunt for Reverend Trimpy. I've hidden 4 eggs that are going to help her tell the Easter story. Now, she's going to look for the first egg, and here's her hint. Don't look high, look low, look somewhere near your toes. I think maybe Reverend Trimpy has found something.
I found my first egg. Let's see what's inside. It is a cross made out of nails. I bet this has something to do with the Easter story. It reminds me that on the Friday before Easter, Jesus died on the cross for you and for me because he loves us so much.
So Reverend Trimpe, here's our next clue. It's not in the fridge, it's not on the ridge, but you may want to look near the bridge. I think Reverend Trimpe has found it.
I found my second egg. I know it's got something to do with the Easter story. Let's see what's inside. A rock reminds us that on that first Easter morning, on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, but they found the stone rolled away and no one was inside.
Okay, Reverend Trimpe, so here is our next clue for egg number 3. Don't be anxious, don't fret, but to find this one, you must get wet. So Reverend Trimpe is looking in the streams by the church. Now, Reverend Trimpe, be careful. You never know what is in some of these streams. I think maybe Reverend Trimpe has spotted it. Let's see. Oh, look, there it is. She's making her way. Will she get wet or not? Let's see. All right, egg number 3.
I found it. That one was tough. Let's see what's in this egg. Piece of cloth. After Jesus died and they brought him down from the cross, they wrapped his body in a cloth and they laid him in the tomb. But that Sunday morning when the women went to the tomb, they found the cloth, just the cloth, but no body. They were really confused. Where could Jesus be?
We found 3 of our eggs so far. Our final clue says, look where a bird would build its nest. Chances are you'll find the rest. Well, let's don't look there. Let's don't look there either. I think maybe Reverend Trimpe has found the final egg.
My last egg. We've been talking about the Easter story and I think I know what's inside, and kids, I bet you know what's inside too. So say it with me nice and loud. What's in this egg? Nothing, absolutely nothing. Why? Because Jesus' body was not in that tomb on Easter Sunday morning. Remember, the women had gotten there and there was no body, there was just the cloth. That's confusing. Where could Jesus have gone? But they turned around and they saw Jesus himself right there. And they knew he was not dead, he was alive. Let's pray. Dear God, we are so thankful for Easter Sunday morning. And for the truth that the tomb is empty because Jesus has risen from the dead. Hallelujah. What amazingly great good news that is. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you that he rose from the dead. Thank you for his love and the eternal life that he gives us. In his name we pray. Amen.
Well, on this Easter Sunday morning, we certainly have a lot to pray about. And so I would invite you to join with me in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this very special celebration today of your resurrection. Lord, we recognize that we live in an unusual moment in our nation and our world. And we ask for your grace. Lord, we pray for all of those who are working so diligently on this difficulty and problem. We pray for scientists and medical doctors who are working to find cures and vaccines, and we pray that you will bless them and that you will speed their work. Oh God, we pray for our healthcare workers and all of those who are tending to those who are sick. We pray that you will keep them safe and guard them by your grace and your hand. May they be the hands of Jesus to extend your mercy and your kindness and your tender touch to those in need. Lord, we pray that for those who are particularly vulnerable to this particular virus, and we pray that you'll watch over them and protect them and keep them in your grace and surround them with your care. Lord, for those that are sick, we pray that you will reach down your hand and grant them your healing and your grace and your help in their difficulties. We pray that you will raise them up, O God, so that they might find health and help and life. Lord, you have given us an interesting time in the life of our country that's full of anxiety and confusion and uncertainty. And so we pray for each person that is experiencing that anxiety and that struggle, whether it's over job or family situations or finances or health. We pray that you will grant your peace that transcends understanding, to keep us with confidence and courage and grace in the midst of our struggles and our difficulties and our problems. Lord, may we continue to be a people of prayer. We ask that you'll hear our prayers as a country, and that somehow through this that we might become a people who pray more earnestly, and who recognize the need to always lift our hearts to you. Oh God, we ask now that you'll hear us as we pray the prayer you taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Oh, God has made.
Would you bow your heads with me in prayer? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this remarkable story of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We pray that from it this morning you will give us hope and grace and understanding. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. The scripture reading this morning is from the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 28, beginning with verse 1. This is Matthew's account of the resurrection. Now, after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothing white as snow, and for fear of him the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Come see the place where he lay, then go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, we come this morning to the great day in the life of the church that speaks to us about hope. And we live in a moment in time in which perhaps more than any other moment in recent memory, that we certainly need some hope. Now, Saturday after the crucifixion, the followers of Jesus, they really had no hope. They had followed Jesus for 3 years, even when it had cost them friends and prestige and income. They kept following because they were sure that he was the one who was to save the nation. But all of a sudden, between Thursday night about midnight and Friday at 3 p.m., a space of only about 15 hours, everything had fallen apart. Jesus, who had been the master of every situation, had allowed himself to be arrested, to be tried, and to be crucified. He had hung on the cross for 6 hours, and lo and behold, no miracle had happened. God hadn't saved him, and how could this have happened? How could this possibly have happened? And yet, it did. Now, with Jesus dead, all the followers of Jesus could only see darkness. They couldn't see any light at the end of the tunnel. Well, we certainly need some light in the darkness now, don't we, as a country and as a people? I don't know about you, but I'm tired of staying inside, not going out to eat, not going shopping, not going to the grocery store. I happen to be running low on ice cream. And did you know that they've closed the tennis courts all across town? This has to end. Well, there certainly are a lot of uncertainties and anxieties around. Can I stay well? What if I get sick? How will my body respond? Can I get medications that will help me? When will I get back to work? Will my company stay strong? Will there be layoffs? And how is this going to resolve? The number of cases in Georgia continues to go up, as in Clark County and Oconee County. And it's great that there will be a vaccine in 18 months, but that's 18 months, and who will survive if things go on for that long? Well, the words that seem to characterize America today are uncertainty and anxiety. Well, so what does Easter have to do with hope? Well, for the disciples, it would have a lot to do with it. Saturday after the crucifixion had been the Sabbath, and no one went out on the Sabbath, so it had been a day of rest. They stayed inside. They tended their emotional wounds. And the women waited until Sunday morning to take spices to the grave. But early on Sunday morning, as soon as it got light, they were out with spices to see the body, to anoint it, to grieve over it, to look at it one last time, to pay their last respects. But as it turns out, they were in for a great surprise. Matthew reports that as they arrived at the tomb, there was an earthquake, a great earthquake, that was caused by an angel of God descending. The angel rolled back the stone from in front of the tomb, and in confidence he sat on it. Jesus was not going to slink out of the grave. An angel came to break him free and deliver him by force with an earthquake and great power. And so terrifying was the effect that Matthew says that the soldiers shook with fear and became like dead men. The angel spoke to the women kindly, however. He said, "Don't be afraid. I know you've come looking for Jesus who was crucified. He's not here, for he is risen. Come and see the place where he lay. He's no longer there. Then go and tell the disciples quickly that he is risen from the dead, and he will see them in Galilee." Now, there are several important things about the words of the angels. First, he says to the women, he said, "You're in the right place. You're looking for Jesus who was crucified. This is the place, but he is not here." Next, he says, Jesus is not here because he's risen from the grave. He isn't dead any longer, and the proof is that his body is no longer where it was. In addition, he says, and the disciples need to know this quickly. The time for despair, the time for sadness is over. Go and tell them that Jesus Christ has risen. Also, he says, tell them they'll see him in person. Tell the disciples to go to Galilee, and there he will appear to them. Finally, the angel says, you can trust my words because I've been sent from God to tell you this good news. Well, and Matthew says that the women did as the angel instructed. Now, the account of the resurrection is told in all four Gospels, and Matthew seems to telescope some of its moments. Apparently, some of the women went back and told the disciples what they had heard before Christ appeared to them. But at one point, Jesus appears to all of the women together, and Matthew reports that. It says that Jesus appeared to them, and they worshiped him, and he said, "Don't be afraid, but go and tell my disciples that I have risen." And so it would be. Well, the disciples would also see Jesus. He would appear to two disciples walking on the way to the village called Emmaus that evening. He would appear to Peter sometime later that afternoon, although we don't have an account of it. Then to the disciples later that evening with everyone there but Thomas. And then a week later, he would appear to all the disciples with Thomas present. And in Galilee, he would appear to them a number of times. And the Apostle Paul says he would even appear to 500 people together at the same time. That was over a period of 40 days before he ascended into heaven. And all of that was to prove that he was really alive. This wasn't a kind of spiritual or mystical resurrection, but it was a real bodily resurrection. Jesus Christ had been raised from the dead. Now, so why is the resurrection of Jesus important? It's because the cross is about forgiveness, but the resurrection is about hope. The cross purchases our salvation, and the resurrection, well, it makes that transaction final. The cross pays our debt and reconciles us to God, and the resurrection gives us eternal life in the kingdom of God and with Christ as our Savior. And the resurrection says that nothing is impossible with God. Now, you know, it's easy to take the complexities of the resurrection for granted. We may think of the resurrection like one of those mad scientist movies where the scientist creates a human being. And it's a dark, stormy night, and he's in his secret laboratory in the mountains, and he's waiting for the lightning to strike, and finally it does, and it sends voltage through the body, and the body quivers, and the scientist cries, "It's alive!" And the monster awakes. Well, it turns out, however, that a resurrection would not be like that at all. A medical doctor named Thomas Miller did an examination of issues surrounding the resurrection. And he noted particularly, as a medical doctor, what happens when a person dies. And he notes particularly that when a person dies, every cell in the body dies. And that is, for most people, about 37 trillion of them. For example, only several minutes after death, cells become deprived of oxygen. Toxic byproducts build up in the cells. Enzymes begin to digest the cell membranes, and they leak out as the cells break down. Damaged blood cells spill out through broken vessels and spread throughout the body. And once our immune system stops working, the bacteria that had been held in check begins to spread freely throughout the body. In the 3 days that Jesus was dead, bacteria would have spread throughout his body. So what would it take to raise a dead person, a dead body, back to life? Well, it would take immense power and ability. I mean, you can't just jolt it with lightning. You would need to go into each cell, all 37 trillion of them, and make repairs. You have to put them back together. You have to rebuild them. And since they're not all alike and they have different functionings, well, you'd have to do each one individually. And so it would be an impossible task. It would be 37 trillion little impossible tasks. And who could do that? Who could possibly do such a thing? Well, it's impossible, except for God. It's impossible except for God, but that is exactly what God did. Well, if you think about it, if God can raise someone from the dead, anything is impossible. Anything is possible with God. Well, we might ask, if God is big enough for our problems today, is God big enough for our country's problems and our world's problems and our problems? Well, it turns out that we have a God to whom nothing is impossible. And in a time of anxiety, that should be a comfort to us. Whatever our trouble, whatever our situation, whatever our anxieties, we have a God for whom nothing is impossible. He raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Now, this Easter tells us then that God is a God of great hope. With God, there's always hope. He's not a God of despair. If you think about it, God didn't leave the disciples in despair for 3 days. It might have been longer, it might have been a month, but he didn't want to leave them in despair. He wanted them to have hope. He wanted him to know that with every ending, there is the possibility of a beginning, and even death can become life where God is involved. Well, someone asked, what is the Christian response in this time of national difficulty? Someone said, what's the Christian explanation for this pandemic? And what does Christianity have to say about why this is happening? And I think there are two possible answers to that. One comes from John Calvin and the prophets. I was reading some theology this week, as I am wont to do, especially at night, in the middle of the night when I wake up and can't go back to sleep. There's nothing to make you drowsy like a little bit of John Calvin. Well, and I was reading where Calvin was talking about repentance, and he noted that God sometimes sends calamities to turn us back to himself and lead us to repentance. Here's what Calvin says. He says, whenever God shows us some sign of calamity, he is announcing to us that he is ready to do vengeance and already armed with it. It is God's signal to a sinful world that it ought to turn back to God. Well, that's echoed by the prophets, Amos chapter 4 and verse 10, for example. In that verse, God says to the people, he says, I sent among you pestilence after the manner of Egypt, and I killed your young men with the sword and carried away your horses, yet you did not return to me. Well, from the prophetic point of view, when God allows trouble, it's his call for us to repent from our sins, to turn our hearts back to God and renew our faith. Well, do we need to do this as a country? Do we need to do this as a world? Well, we should not. The answer to that question should be obvious. Do we as America need to repent of our sins? Are we ripe for God's judgment for a variety of reasons? Well, the answer is obviously yes. Well, so here we have an opportunity. We have an opportunity. Perhaps this is a trumpet call from God that says, come back to me. That says, in true repentance with all your hearts, come back to me. Turn from your sins as a nation. Cease to be evil and learn to do good. Forsake the wrong and turn your hearts back to what's right. Repent and truly repent and call on me. And if you will call on me, I will hear your voice and hear your prayers and I will answer. And I will come and heal your land. Well, that's what we need to do in this time, isn't it? If this is God's judgment, in some sense, there certainly is some mercy to it. We're not in the middle of a world war where all of our children are going overseas to war. It's not polio or smallpox or Ebola. And God's judgments are terrible, but always with grace. Well, it seems to me that we have a time of reset as a nation. We're getting a little pause, if you think about it. Maybe a time to reflect on our ways, time to stop our endless activity, time to humble our pride, a time in which nothing is the same as the way it was. The fragile nature of life is brought home to us, and the need for God is more evident. The need for God is more evident, and the need for prayer is more evident as well. Now, I wonder if it's possible that God will raise up at the end of this a different people, a different nation, less proud, more open to God, less wicked, a little kinder with one another. And you know, many of us have been praying for a revival throughout our country and our land. And one might wonder, is this the opportunity God is giving us to see a new heart and a new spirit in our country? And I hope and I pray that it is. Well, I said there was a second answer to the question about what Christianity has to say in a time like this. And British theologian N.T. Wright says that the Bible doesn't give us quick and easy answers to all our problems. There's not necessarily a Christian answer as to why something like this takes place. But rather, the Bible's response is lament. In times of trouble, God's people cry out to God. Just under one-third of the Psalms in the book of Psalms are laments, cries to God in time of trouble. And the books of the prophets are in many ways laments in which the prophets are crying out to God because of the sins of God's people and God's coming judgment upon them for those sins. And yet in all of the laments in the Bible, there's hope. There's always hope in God's grace. No matter how great the trouble, no matter how impossible seeming the crisis, there is hope because God is able to save. Well, Easter is about hope, that not even death is too hard for God. And so then, again, why is the Easter message of Jesus' resurrection so important? Well, the answer is because there is a disease that's more deadly than coronavirus. It's more dangerous, it's more deadly, it's more permanent. It's a disease called sin. It infects every person, has no cure. Its mortality rate is 100%, and worst of all, its death is not just physical, but it's spiritual, and it is eternal. It is a disease that brings about eternal death and separation from God. And can there be any more disease more terrifying than that? A disease that will separate one from God for all eternity. Well, that's why the cross and the resurrection matter. Sin is a disease that science cannot fix because it is spiritual and it needs a spiritual solution. And that's what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. God sent Jesus Christ into the world to become the world's Savior, to give His very life on the cross for our sakes, and to rise from the dead as the sign to us that His sacrifice is in fact effective and acceptable to the Father for the forgiveness of sins. Jesus has paid the price for us. He has provided the cure. He is the vaccine about that provides for us healing from the disease of sin that reunites us to God and that brings us back into the very family of God Himself. Well, you know, our current problems will pass. There will be an end. We will go back to work. Our children and young people will go back to school. There will be a football season, hopefully, this fall, Monday night, September the 7th, against Virginia, Mercedes-Benz Stadium in Atlanta. Be there. Church will meet again in person. We will. And God does not forsake us in this life. God does not forsake us in this life. He gives us many graces and many hopes. And our nation's medical abilities are, they are a gift from God, and they are part of God's grace to us, and they will find ways to help us in our circumstance. But here's the message of Easter, and it's crucially important. All of these temporal things are nothing if we don't have an eternal hope. All of these temporary things, as nice as they are nothing if they don't rest on an eternal hope. And that is what God has given us in Jesus Christ. And that's the good news of Easter. Christ rose from the dead, and God has given us an eternal foundation on which to build our lives and an eternal salvation in Him. And with it comes the promise of eternal life. Well, so we have salvation and eternal life in Christ, and that being the case, we can endure. We can endure whatever comes and do so with faith and with courage and with hope. Let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You for this marvelous message of hope that comes to us on Easter. Lord, we admit that we are a people in need of repentance. We are a people in need of changing our ways. Oh God, help us in this time of pause and reset and reflection to remember what's important, to turn our hearts back to You in a new and a fresh way, so that we might rise up different, so that we might be a different people in a different nation, more righteous, more holy, and our lives more attuned to You. Oh God, thank You for loving us so much. Thank You for raising Your Son from the dead. Thank You that in Him we have grace and hope and life and peace. Through Jesus Christ we make these prayers. Amen. We thank you again for joining us today for this Easter service of worship. We hope that you'll continue to worship with us at Alps Road Presbyterian Church. And as long as this goes on, we will have an online presence. And we thank you for being with us for this very special service. We pray that God will bless you and watch over you, that He will keep you in His grace in the coming week. Stay safe, God's blessings, and we love you very much. Would you bow your heads with me for prayer? Heavenly Father, we ask now that you will watch over each person that's listening to this and their families. We pray that you will continue to grant us your grace and help as a community so that we might experience your healing, your renewal, and experience your help in time of trouble. Oh God, hear these prayers. We love you very much, and we pray them in Christ's name. Amen. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Father in heaven, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all, both now and forevermore. Amen.